Do you know what's in New Hampshire's new state budget? We have the details next on The State We're In. Hello, welcome to The State We're In. I'm Melanie Plenda. New Hampshire's new budget has been signed and in effect for nearly a month. It contains a number of policy changes that aren't related to taxes or spending, abortion, education, and more. What could these changes mean for Granite Staters? Well, joining us now to break it down is Anna Brown of Citizens Count. Anna, welcome.
Great to be here, Melanie.
So let's start with the numbers. The new budget is spending more than $13 billion over the next 2 years. There are lots of tax cuts. What are they?
Some of the biggest changes coming through are to business taxes. The business profits tax is going from 7.7% to 7.6%, and there's also a decrease in the business enterprise tax. Meanwhile, the filing threshold for both of those taxes is increasing, which means that smaller businesses won't necessarily have to file. That's notable because there was bipartisan support on that change. There's also going to be a phasing out of the interest and dividends tax, which, depending on which sides you talk to, is either a great tax break for seniors who are living off of investment-related income, or alternatively, a tax break for some of New Hampshire's richest residents that really don't need the help right now. If you're wondering what could impact you no matter what, there's a $100 million statewide property tax cut that will go towards the state's share of school funding, which is out of property taxes. So localities will still get that money from the state from other sources, but it means that the state portion of your property tax bill should go down. And then the last one worth noting is a cut to the meals and rooms tax from 9% to 8.5%. These tax cuts will roll out over the next few years, so you might not see the changes immediately.
Over time, though, do we know yet how that's going to impact people in the state?
Well, ideally, this is going to stimulate business activity. It ideally will help restaurants rebound from the coronavirus pandemic. But there's a lot of questions about really how the revenue picture is going to unfold over the next few years. Is the economy going to continue its rebound from the brief coronavirus recession? Or are we going to hit roadblocks? Is inflation going to be a problem? Are restaurants going to struggle to get back their customers? Is the workforce shortage going to hurt businesses' ability to expand? Meanwhile, there's still a lot of federal coronavirus relief money coming in that makes it harder to sort out exactly where New Hampshire's revenue picture is going to end up.
And going back a bit to the state portion of the school funding, how is that going to impact school districts, do we know?
This is going to be very complex and probably changing town to town and school district to school district, because theoretically, the local towns set their own property tax rate beyond that state rate. So they may take this extra cut from the state and say, great, we're just slashing that. On the other hand, they might be raising the local property tax for other school investments that they want to do. There's also budget money that's going to school building aid, so projects such as a new expansion or a roof or something like that. So when you look from a town-to-town basis, it's hard to say exactly across the board, this is going to make it easier for school funding or harder for school funding, there will be more of a local burden or less, because there's another important X factor we need to talk about here. This newest budget included education freedom accounts as kind of a voucher program. Technically, they're not vouchers because what happens is the money goes to a student's parent. And so they get the state share of school funding. Now, that can be spent on private schooling, online schooling, other education expenses such as uniforms or maybe a course materials if you're homeschooling. So this theoretically will draw down the amount of state school funding that localities are getting. But there's a phase out, and then there's also long term, you know, it might not be that many students taking it up, or it could be a lot of students taking it up, and it could have a very large negative impact on school funding coming into towns. So it's going to be a very interesting next couple of years to see how much in your town is the state going to be contributing.
Interesting. Now, there are other provisions in the budget that aren't connected to spending, and they have been creating some confusion among New Hampshire residents. So what does it mean when there is policy within the budget that doesn't include taxes or spending?
The budget always has two bills. There's HB1, which is basically just an Excel spreadsheet of where the money is coming and going. Mm-hmm. And then there's HB2, which are any policy changes that need to support the budget. So, for example, I talked about that education savings account program. Mm-hmm. That would be part of HB2. Now, this year, the House of Representatives in particular chose to include certain policy priorities in that HB2 policy bill that aren't directly related to how money gets spent in the state. And this was partly to force Governor Sununu's hand, because some of these policy choices they knew might get a veto from Governor Sununu or might have trouble passing on their own. So they included them to make sure, as sort of a safety catch, that saying these are top priorities for us, we absolutely want them to go through. And Governor Sununu did in fact say, I don't like all of this, but I'm not going to veto the budget over it. And so it was a successful political strategy, not one that I've seen very commonly used in New Hampshire. Usually smaller policy changes might get squeaked in. For example, a few years ago, they raised the smoking age from 18 to 19. These were bigger issues. So it'll be interesting to see if this sort of sets a new precedent in New Hampshire, or if future budgets tend to just stay away from other big policy changes.
That's interesting. And so what are some of those provisions that made it in this time?
There are three in particular that I think really got a lot of attention. One is abortion restrictions, which we can talk about. It was a late-term abortion ban. There's some other requirements in terms of auditing funding. Emergency power restrictions related to the COVID-19 pandemic. That was very important to the so-called Freedom Caucus in the House that was concerned about how Governor Sununu used those emergency powers. And then lastly, there's a portion of the bill that is attempting to ban the teaching of critical race theory in schools and also municipal and state trainings and those sorts of things.
So digging into those a little deeper, we talked to the governor last week about the so-called divisive concepts language that ended up in the bill. He said that phrase does not exist in the legislation he signed. What are people saying about it now?
Yes. And to clarify, he's correct that the original version of that piece of legislation talked about all manner of quote-unquote divisive concepts that were related to critical race theory, related to examining unconscious and implicit biases. And the Senate rewrote that part of the bill, so it's not defined as divisive concepts. It becomes part of the state's anti-discrimination law. But what exactly it means and what exactly the implementation will look like is not clear. We are still waiting from guidance from the Attorney General and the Department of Education about what exactly is going to be off limits in these trainings, because the way the law is written can be a little vague. And we also know that we are in a time when many municipalities, some law enforcement, private businesses, even schools are talking about what is implicit or unconscious bias. Are there systems in place in our country that do have a racial bias one way or another? And so they're looking at these trainings and they're asking themselves, could we run afoul of this new state law? Mm-hmm. That's why that guidance is going to be so critical. Meanwhile, people are saying it doesn't matter what the ultimate implementation is. We are already now experiencing that this is having a chilling effect on conversations about implicit bias, race, how it all acts together in New Hampshire society and in our government. Mm-hmm. So the New Hampshire Business Industry Association, for example, has pinpointed this as an issue next year they might look to repeal, because they're concerned that it's going to turn off a diverse and younger workforce from moving to New Hampshire. State officials, meanwhile, have said that these conversations can move forward, just wait for the guidance.
Interesting. We'll definitely be watching that one. So could you share how the new abortion restrictions impact Granite Staters?
New Hampshire now has a ban on abortions after 24 weeks gestation. And as part of that, there is now a requirement for providers to conduct an ultrasound before an abortion to ensure that the fetus is not over 24 weeks. So if you are seeking an abortion in New Hampshire, to be clear, there's not a ban on abortion. If it's prior to 24 weeks, there's nothing else like that. And then if it's after 24 weeks, there is an exception if there is an emergency for the mother's health. Not emergencies, not for rape or incest or other concerns. So There are many other states that also have restrictions on late-term abortions. New Hampshire's is a little different in that it does include criminal penalties for doctors who complete an abortion after 24 weeks if it's not a medical emergency for the mother. It also gives the right for fathers and other parties to sue potentially. So if you're an average Granite Stater, what's the impact on you? Well, I think that, you know, it's sort of where you stand on this abortion-related issue. We already know that late-term abortions are very rare in New Hampshire. Providers testified to that fact. Some abortion providers just won't perform it after 24 weeks. So I think that perhaps a more nuanced question is going to be, how is that ultrasound requirement going to impact insurance rates, if at all? Because the state has said that insurance will have to cover this new ultrasound mandate. But we all know health insurance is an incredibly complex issue where various little changes can be passed on to the consumer or create other unintended healthcare costs. And hopefully we won't see our health insurance. I'm not implying that there's going to be some massive health insurance bill change that we're seeing. But that law, if you're looking at how could it impact you, even if you aren't a woman who is interested in bearing a child, that's a question.
Sure. And what about the changes to the governor's emergency powers? Anything new there with this legislation?
A lot of the changes are really just about asking the governor to keep the legislature more informed. Originally, the House Freedom Caucus wanted to require the legislature to affirmatively vote to continue an emergency beyond 21 days. All of that got scaled back. So at this point, after 90 days of an emergency, the governor is required to give a joint address to the House and Senate and explain the reason for the emergency, explain what's going on, and then both the House and Senate can vote. And if a majority votes to end the emergency, at that point, it does. Now, there's also some spending oversight, which was really important, for example, to Democrats during 2020. There was a lawsuit over some of the federal money that Sununu was spending without approval from the Legislative Fiscal Committee. So this new requirement would require the governor seek approval for spending over certain amounts with that legislative committee. Now, if they don't act within 5 days and it's emergency, the governor can still expend the funds. So this is another example about how basically the legislature is going to be ideally be more informed and there's going to be more opportunities for oversight. But it's not really severely restricting the governor's powers if there is, for example, a new wave outbreak of the coronavirus.
Sure. And there seems to be a significant commitment to mental health in the new budget. Can you talk about that?
Yes. One of the most important pieces was funding for a new secure psychiatric hospital in New Hampshire. Right now, patients that are considered an extreme danger to themselves or others that can't be handled in that traditional healthcare setting are actually housed in the state prison for men. So this is obviously problematic on multiple levels. A prison is not really a healthcare facility, obviously. It's not supposed to be housing patients who have not committed a crime. So this was funded actually a couple years ago in the last budget cycle, but Sununu put a freeze on all state spending during that coronavirus emergency right at the beginning. So this project didn't go forward. So this is committed in the new budget that's going forward. It's really a delayed project, though. There is also additional funding going for more beds and providers, et cetera. But this is a long-term problem in New Hampshire. And even though there is some more funding, I think that there will still be issues in terms of attracting workforce and attracting mental health providers to come to New Hampshire and deliver these critical services.
Sure. So what was the most surprising addition to you and why was that?
One thing we haven't talked about is Governor's new paid family and medical leave plan, which he included in this budget, and lots of squidginess around the edges in terms of how exactly this is going to work for every single employee. The gist of it is that the government will pay for state employees to have paid family and medical leave insurance, and that will create a base pool for a private insurer to come in and offer family and medical leave insurance to individuals and larger employers in the state. The law specifies that it will be note for individuals, it will not be a premium over $5 a month, that it will cover 60% of pay for 6 weeks. Now, there's a lot of questions around that. What about not individuals filing, but those larger employers who are going to have to work with the insurer? What sort of rates are they going to have? What costs might be there for the state going forward? There's a completely new plan. There's no common plan that exists in another state at this point. So it was kind of a big risk for a lot of more fiscally conservative Republicans who were looking at that and saying, I have a lot of question marks. Meanwhile, some Democrats were looking at it and saying, I'm not convinced this is going to be affordable for your average person or provide enough coverage statewide or maybe be sustainable if not enough people sign up to support these premiums. So it's a little bit of a question how that's going to be implemented, what it's going to look like. And so that's partly why it was such a surprise to me that it did get included in that budget. I think when you look at some of the concessions Sununu made on emergency powers, for example, which was something he was very hesitant to move forward with, I think that this was something else that he said and that, okay, I'm giving you a little leeway. Now you give me a little leeway. Let's put this program in.
Anna Brown of Citizens Count, thank you so much for sharing your insights with us.
Thank you, Melanie.
Conversation continues online. We want to hear from you. What are your thoughts on the policy changes within the budget? Visit our Facebook page at collaborativenh.org and let us know. Thank you for watching, and we'll see you next time on The State We're In.